Mackenzie, you lost your sister Shelby to suicide in 2014. Tell me what she was like.
Shelby was an amazing person. She was the most caring and empathetic person I've ever met. She was also a really funny and incredibly intelligent person.
That's not the picture that you think of when you think of someone who has depression.
So many people were so shocked when she passed away, but tick sort of all those boxes that you would think of someone that is high achieving. She got straight A's, she had friends.
But she struggled.
She definitely struggled. Shelby had major depressive disorder. Shelby also had anxiety and an eating disorder as well.
And was help available?
It was really challenging to find that care for her. The process of trying to find a therapist was extremely challenging, especially a therapist that met all of her needs. When Shelby was hospitalized for an attempted suicide, you know, finding her a residential program that could treat both her depression and the eating disorder was really hard.
Terrible for families who are left behind because they must feel pain, grief, and guilt as well. How do they cope?
There's really no words to describe how painful it is to lose somebody. And the most important thing is whatever the grieving process is like for you, to make sure that you let that process take its course of in whatever way feels right. There's so many almost rules or that other people are trying to tell you how to grieve, and there is no answer to what the right way is, and that can look completely different for two different people.
Did you find in your family that all of you grieve together or that you grieve the same way?
My mom, for her, being around our family and sharing stories about Shelby and talking about what she was feeling and how much she missed my sister was really helpful for her. But for me, I was almost too fragile in a place to talk about how much I missed my sister, and I really just needed to be able to remember those happy moments with Shelby and be around other people who didn't have those expectations.
After your sister passed, how did you channel your grief and your pain? What did you want to do something to honor her, to help others?
It sort of happened organically because after Shelby passed away, you know, I just spent so much time thinking about what I could have done better. That's a large part of stigma, is because you're so afraid of saying the wrong thing that oftentimes you don't say anything at all. And because mental health disorders are mind disorders, you can't put yourself in their shoes to know what they've been through. Because I can't know what depression feels like if I've never been depressed myself. Over time, I realized that your job is to be a supporter and to listen. And I wanted to go back and tell myself all these tips, but I didn't know how to do that. And so I realized that that was going to be in the form of a website. And that ended up morphing into TEAM, which is teaching everyone about mental health, a pocket guide to help teach other friends and family members of how they can be supportive to a loved one who's experiencing mental illness. So you can go to myteam.org to learn about what to do or say. How do I go about reaching out to someone to talk to them about if I think that they're struggling with their mental health? How do I start that conversation? And so we help walk you through, you know, what to do, what to say, and to hold your hand through that process.
How has TEAM grown since you started it?
It's amazing the amount of people who have reached out and who have written stories to share. One of the things we do on TEAM is to create sort of an online community where we have peer-to-peer sharing through storytelling. So by telling your story of how mental health has affected you or your family members, and then what would be helpful, something that someone can say or do in the future to be more supportive. And then on the website, we have professional advice on what you can do and say in certain situations.
So one day you put up the website with no expectations, and what happened?
And it's really taken off. We have, you know, tens of thousands of people every year that visit TEAM. In our online community, we have thousands of followers. It's been a really incredible journey just to see how TEAM has sort of grown organically.
So people realize by going online, by seeing others sharing their story, they're not alone?
Mm-hmm. By seeing they're not alone, by seeing that others have experienced the same things, it has this sort of domino effect where other people want to go on and share their story as well, because they know that by sharing their story, it's not only almost therapeutic for them in a way, but it also can help a lot of other people in the process.
What's the advice you give to families who are in a similar situation to yours? First dealing with someone with depression and then having lost someone.
My advice to families is that there is fantastic treatment out there. And there is hope that somebody who is struggling can get better when you do identify the right treatment. And it's something that the earlier you can start to treat it, the better.
In the process of reaching out to help someone who is depressed or suffers from a mental illness, what about taking care of yourself?
Making sure you take care of yourself is extremely important. And that's another thing we talk about on team is, what is that fine line of being supportive but not at the expense of your own mental health? Because checking in with your own mental health and making sure that you are feeling really great as well through the process and maintaining your own mental health is important, because you can't help somebody else unless you yourself take care of your own mental health.
Mackenzie, thank you so very much for team and also for sharing with us.
Thank you so much.